Hi everyone, my name's Peta. I'm the manager of the Business School Career Centre and this is my colleague Tamsin. So thank you for coming. We weren't quite sure how many people would come considering it's just after the Easter break and the storm that never happened. So we'll start off just very quickly with a quiz, just get your brains warmed up a little bit. So, on average, an employer spends only 2 minutes looking at each CV. Is that right or wrong? Correct? Who thinks it's correct?
Yep.
Who thinks it's incorrect? Okay, so this is going to freak some of you out. Snap judgment. So we will talk quite a bit about first impressions, and this is pretty much why first impressions are so important. Having lots of white space, formatting really neat and tidy. So when an employer looks at a CV, they'll go really quickly, sort of speed reading. So that's why it's just so important, the whole first impressions. We'll talk a little bit more about that. It's also surprising how quickly you can pick stuff up when you look at a CV. So I used to get some shockers when I was in recruitment. So one of them was written on the back of a telecom letter. And I thought, I spent longer than 10 seconds because I was flipping it back and forth. I wasn't sure what I was seeing. And I was thinking, was this their draft? Were they trying to say they were good at recycling? I wasn't quite sure. And then there were some others that I got. By the second one, I was thinking, this looks familiar. By the third one, I was thinking, no. So I went back through my piles. It was exactly the same CV, 3 times with a different name each time. So I don't know what that was about. But you got get some with coffee stains when that was in the days of mailing. It's really amazing how bad some are. And just the formatting, you can see spelling mistakes really quickly. So the 10 seconds is actually accurate. This is information that employers have provided with us, by the way. Oh, I'm giving you the answer. It's okay to use the same CV and cover letter for every application? Yeah. So tailoring is really important. There's really only one way to write a CV. Who thinks that's incorrect? Yeah. You don't always need to include a cover letter. Think you do, think you do. How many think you don't? Ah.
It depends on how you're actually applying
though. It does depend.
Sometimes you actually fill in a lot of the cover letters anyway.
Yeah. So sometimes there's an online application form, sometimes that's replacing cover letters, and we'll talk more about at the end about that. So not all employers want cover letters these days, so checking the employer's requirements is really important. We've got one final one for you.
No.
I know, it's really sad these days. Sometimes you just never hear a thing from employers, so it is okay to follow up after a couple of weeks.
My favourite story was one for myself, and I applied, and then about 3 weeks later they rang me up and asked me if I wanted a temping job there, and I said, so I'm guessing I didn't get the other job then. And they said, oh, didn't someone tell you? So they'd forgotten that, yeah.
Oops. So let's just get you warmed up a little bit, and we will be covering a lot of these points in more detail. What we're covering this evening is CVs and cover letters. We'll talk about the employer's perspective. And then interpreting job advertisements. It is really crucial to have a look at the job advertisement, the job description if there is one, and mine it for as much data as you can get. Principles of effective CV writing. There are some sort of common principles. And then how to tailor your CV and cover letter. And then also what to be aware of for the future, so future trends. The aim of your application isn't to get the job. At this point, it's actually to get an interview. So that's what you're trying to do. And these days, we talk a lot about personal branding. So it's not something that, I would say that it's, particularly in the last 5 years, it's really gained traction. But it was about 97, I think it was first started to be talked about. So we used to have sort of McDonald's or Auckland City Council or the University of Auckland having a brand. But we've also all got personal brands. And in terms of the job application, we're sort of showing our talent, our values, our passion, our strengths, our experience, our ideals. All of those things come together to form our brand. So we're showing to trying to also show that there's an alignment between our brand and their brand, that we've got what the employer is looking for. Just a few figures. So a large employer gave us these figures about a year or so ago. So for a normal job, they would expect about 250 applications. So it is really important that you stand out. Time spent reviewing your CV, they actually were less generous than us. They said 5 to 7 seconds. 200 seconds. So as soon as they put an ad online, 200 seconds later, they will get their first application. Unless those people knew that the ad was coming up, they won't be that tailored. And then 68% chance an employer will find you on Facebook, and then 1 in 3 chance they'll reject you based on something in social media. It varies very much, those last 2 points, from employer to employer. So some do spend a lot of time looking on social media. They might not do it at the very beginning of the process, but if when they're working on their shortlist, then they might look at social media. If they've got 2 candidates who are very similar and they're not quite sure which ones to choose, then they might look at social media. How many of you have actually Googled yourself? Yeah, so you might want to Google yourself and just see what comes up and see it from an employer's perspective, what the employer would think of what they're seeing. From their perspective as well, so they've really stressed that they want something that's succinct. So as short as you possibly can. So just go through it, look at every word that you use. One shot only. So I talked before about sort of less than 10 seconds. So that's why the presentation, the formatting, the layout is also really important. So this is particularly when it comes to the CV. There it sort of like says, use words wisely, make every word count, no spelling mistake. In a CV, you can use bullet points, but in a cover letter, we suggest you don't use bullet points. So the cover letter is your chance to show that you've got really good written communication skills and can form complete sentences. But in the CV, you want to make it as short and succinct as possible, so you wouldn't have complete sentences, so bullet points are really helpful in that particular case. You research the company, so you're trying to, once again, it's that brand alignment, show that you're relevant, that you are the right person for the job. You don't just copy and paste stuff that you see from the website, particularly when it comes to the cover letter. So in the cover letter, you're saying why you want the job and why you want to work for that company. So you wouldn't just go onto the website and just sort of copy and paste a few sentences that you find. You need to sort of go deeper than that. 2 things that they really do want to know is why you want the job and why you want to work for that particular company. So they are really important. So it's that enthusiasm thing. They can teach you what you might need to know for the job, but they can't inject you with enthusiasm if you don't originally have it. Yeah. So New Zealand spelling. So some of these things you'll get, some employers don't care, but the ones that do care really do care. So you're sort of catering to those ones. It's the same in terms of the fonts that you use. So you try and use an easy to read font and something that's more modern. So one of my colleagues used to loathe and detest Times New Roman, whereas I don't mind, but some employers are the same. Some of the easier ones like Arial or Calibri are better than something like that, apparently. So it's all very subjective. Active words to make more impact, and we'll give you a website link so you can sort of find a list of keywords for you. It is a good idea once you've been in the workforce for a while to explain gaps. So just so they know that you haven't been in prison. I don't know why their mind would go to prison, but apparently that's what they say. So just explain the gaps. And always try and put a positive spin on things as well. So if it was prison, yeah, I'm not quite sure how you'd do that, but build skills and achievements into your work experience. So some of the employers will talk later about the different types of CVs, but a recent trend is not to have a skills section and instead to incorporate the skills into the work experience part, and we'll talk more about that in a little while. And then education and work experience is reverse chronological order. So the idea behind that is the most recent will be the most relevant. It's not always the case though. So what you can do with that is use subheadings. So if it's work experience, for example, you might have relevant work experience as the heading, and then those jobs that are most relevant, and then you might have further work experience. It's just so that you always have whatever is the most relevant at the top. So you can use little tricks like that, so using subheadings is a good way of doing it. You also don't have to put every job you've ever had. In terms of, you can make it clear that you've done that when it comes to the headings. So as I said, it might be relevant work experience, it could be recent work experience. So you don't have to put every single job. I'll just hand over to Tamsin.
Okay, so of course, one of the most important things to sort of kick off the process is actually looking at those job ads, really looking in depth at those job ads. So look, often people will just look at the bullet points, and yeah, you'll get some really sort of interesting stuff out of those bullet points, but look beyond that. Are there any implied messages? Are there any keywords or phrases that are used in that job ad? Are there any qualities that they're mentioning? Or are they just mentioning skills? Is there any repetition? And really checking the employer requirements. And Peter talked a little bit earlier about making sure that you do what the employer requires. If they say, do not send a cover letter, then you send a cover letter, then they're going to think, okay, this person does not have attention to detail. And if that's one of the requirements of that job, that could be a bit of an issue. So it can be a bit of an issue, a bit of a problem if you really don't go into some detail. Another thing that is important is to look at what format they've asked for the application to be in. Sometimes they might ask for a PDF. Sometimes they might ask for you not to send a PDF. They may ask for you to send it all in one document. When I applied here at the university for this job, I thought, oh great, I've got it all ready, just about to send it off in two documents. And then no, it was only to be sent in one document and it was to be sent in PDF. So then I'd go back and spend a little bit more time. Fortunately, I didn't apply for a job that closed at 12 o'clock at 11:59. I had plenty of time, so I was able to do that. But that's another thing. Sometimes, bizarrely enough, they may also have an odd time of day. So check that. Because it'd be awful if you spent all that effort and then discovered that you actually were a few hours late in trying to submit your application. And with a lot of those online application things, it will not let you submit it. So essentially, you're toast. If you don't do it on time, there's no way you're going to be able to apply. I'm going to get my colleague Peter to hand round this book. It's one that's going to be useful in a few of the activities that we've got, but now we're going to click onto an activity. Now you will have noticed me or Peter dropping on your table a job ad. Well, what would I like you to do firstly is actually just look at that ad, suss out what the employer is looking for, read it amongst by yourself, and then as a group, if you can have a good discussion on that, and then we'll do a bit of a feedback session at the end of that. Okay, so bringing you back to the group discussion, keeping in mind these, but I know that out there you've been discussing beyond these ways of analysing, what are some of the key things that you think this employer wants? Feel free to shout it out.
Flexibility.
Flexibility, yes.
A mature person.
Someone mature.
Negotiation skills.
Negotiation skills.
Team, being aware of team, you have to motivate and influence, but also attitude and try new things, take risks, be resilient when they don't work.
Yep. Yep, so there's quite a few mentions of team there, isn't there? Someone said superstar, but they weren't wanting
it. Strong leadership skills.
Strong leadership skills, yes. And it's interesting that doesn't come through so much in those bullet points, does it?
No.
If you looked at those bullet points, you might completely miss out that whole team and leadership aspect of things. That's more implied than actually fully stated.
That's actually a trend we're seeing. They used to be really nice and just have a short blurb and bullet points, and it was really clear what they were looking for. But they seem these days to be doing more like this, where you really need to closely look at the text and the job description, if there is one as well, to really have an idea of what they're wanting. And the repetition is really important, how often they use the same word.
Yeah, so team and leadership, those things around that was one of the things that were repeated. Did other people see repeated improvements?
Change,
yep. Anything else?
Innovation.
Innovation, yes.
Self-motivated.
Self-motivated, yep. One that leapt out at me, service. They mentioned service multiple times in there, yeah. Anything else that leaps out at you, as far as that repetition part of things?
Ownership?
Yep.
There's a sneaky little bit on analysis, which is looking at whether you have improved or not,
isn't it? Yeah, and any other of those implied ones? Yeah, so that's stated, but also it's got a bit about qualifications for process improvement and things, yes. But another thing that was there is that they didn't want someone who was a methodology purist, so that whole adaptability, the change again comes through there.
Customer care,
yeah. Yeah, so as you can see from looking at an ad like this, you can actually find out a lot more than just those bullet points. You can actually get a real sense from the ad of what you might put in your CV and what you might put in your cover letter, the sort of themes that you're going to be wanting to explore and to highlight in those documents have come through quite strongly in the ad. And if you don't actually take those cues, then people who do take the cues, CVs, their documents are going to be actually more persuasive to an employer than if you have taken those cues and if you have actually added those work keywords and things like that to your application.
And helps you in two ways. It helps with the sort of skills, personal qualities they're looking for, but it also helps you sort of start to think about why you actually want to apply for the job. So in the cover letter, as I said before, that's a crucial part of it. And they do talk a lot about innovation and passion. You know, we're passionate about building our culture of award-winning service. So then that's something that you would focus on. But you wouldn't just say that you want to work for them because you're passionate about that. You would actually provide some evidence in your background to show that you've done that and that it is really important, genuinely important to you.
Indeed. Now, it's also important when you're doing these analyses to actually look at the different types of skills and experiences and also the personal qualities. So you'll see on the screen here that in blue are some transferable skills. Really, really important skills that can be transferred from employer to employer. But they're also in italics. They're actually looking for some personal qualities. Harder actually to provide proof in your CV and your cover letter. Some of that is going to be perhaps done at interview, or you might be able to imply back at them that you've got those personal qualities. And then in bold, it's those job-specific skills and experience, some of which are in those the bullet points on that job ad, as you will have noted. So, to sort of hark on about it even more, It's really, really important that you match your skills to the employer's requirements. You need to really closely analyse that job and that job description. Sometimes you might not have the job description, but if you have, mine that as well for every bit of every clue. But don't just look at that. Look at the organisation's literature. Look at their website. Do research on their company. Are there things that come through that might not even be on the ad, but that you think, yes, I shine in that area, so I can actually show in my application that I do shine in that area. So really, really important. And so we've sort of got an example there with regard to teamwork skills, because they don't want you to say, I have teamwork skills, of course. They want you to prove that you've got those teamwork skills. So thinking about what they're looking for, okay, how do I match that? And this will be really useful at interview as well, because if you do that for everything that's required in here, get that interview, and you actually you've then got sort of model answers to a variety of questions. So it's not wasted effort doing this in some detail for jobs that you're really, really interested in. Okay. I guess that the next sort of thing we're going to talk about is CV writing. With that sort of in the back of your mind, what you've done as far as the analysis goes, then actually getting on to writing your CV. We've got some key principles here, and gosh, you could have many, many pages of different principles, couldn't you, Peter? But these, I think, we think are probably the most important ones that you have to keep in mind. So there's that conciseness. It's not a story of your life in great, great detail. Because if they're going to look 5 to 7 seconds, or even the generous 10 seconds, you can't get that much across in that set of time. So be concise. The 3 hours, relevant, remarkable, and recent. Relevant, have you gone through your CV line by line to make sure that everything that you've got in there is relevant to the position and to the opportunity? If it's not relevant, is it worth having there? Is there something else that you can put in your CV that was actually going to sell you better to that employer? Remarkable, well, you want to stand out, don't you? You want to differentiate yourself from the other people who are going for this job. So that's where that remarkable comes in. Recent, well, and that comes back to that question earlier, is that if you use an example that's 25 years old, it's going to be less persuasive than if you use one that's a couple of years old. So that's where that recent comes in. Tailoring to the opportunity, this, as you will have already guessed, is a common theme through this presentation. That's tremendously important to make sure it's tailored to the opportunity. That essentially you're going to rewrite your CV and your cover letter for every job. I reckon it should take at least a day, probably half a day for your CV, half a day for your cover letter, if you're going to really nail it. What do you reckon, Peter? Yeah. And just think, I mean, it may be a real pain, and as we've all applied for jobs, and it can be a pain to really do that tailoring. But just think, if the other people have done that tailoring and you haven't, it's likely that their documentation is going to be more persuasive than yours.
It'll make it a lot easier if you've kept it up to date. So that, say, you make a date with yourself that every year you update your CV, even if you're not planning on applying for a job. And you can have a base CV, and then when you're doing the tailoring, you have basically everything you've done would be in a CV. And then when you're tailoring, you can just look and choose what's relevant out of that base one. We haven't really talked about length and said how many pages, because it would depend very much on the type of job you're going for, the industry that you're working in, even the country that you're applying to. I'm sorry for those of you in the back table, the pillar's in the way. So length does very much depend. So with our students, we try and get them business school specific. We try and get them to do a 2-page CV. But it does very much depend even for them on what job they're going for. So if they were going for a consultancy firm in Australia, we might actually these days be suggesting that they might want to look at a one-page CV. If they were going to the United States, we would definitely say a one-page. So it is just very industry specific, so it's hard to say. But as long as it's not repetitive. And the other really important thing is the most important stuff is on that first page, because they might not get beyond the first page when they're doing that 10-second quick scan. So the first page is the really important part.
And if you're applying for a job as a professor here at the university, your CV could be 50 pages long. And seen as perfectly appropriate to be that length, because you've got all your publications and your presentations and that sort of stuff. So, yeah.
At what point would a CV start to get a little bit of a walk, so I'd say, somebody that's recently graduated, looking sort of for their first job out? At times I sort of feel like, is mine getting a bit long, but then what do I cut out?
Perhaps going through and doing the relevance test on everything is really sort of examining, is this all relevant? Can I summarise some aspects of my experience? Is there anything I can do? Can I put a lot more in my LinkedIn profile and refer them to on my CV? So that can give you extra length outside your CV. Because a recent graduate, you'd kind of be thinking, particularly in business, about that two-pager, or for consultancy, one-pager.
But if they were postgrad, it would be a bit longer, because you'd want to put some research, for example, in there, conference presentations. So there might be extra information that you do need to put in there. So it's very specific, it just depends. If it was a law CV, it might be a bit longer, because they do tend to write more in sentences, as opposed to bullet points.
Okay, using action verbs, I'll talk a little bit more about this, but it's using action verbs makes your CV a little bit more persuasive, because the verbs are quite sort of immediate. And using the correct style for your role and experience, because people will sometimes come to us and say, oh, well, what sort of style should I use? Should I use a skills-based CV? Should I use a traditional CV? Should I use this one that I've found on the internet? And it's all about appropriateness. What is appropriate for that particular role? And also what's appropriate for your experience. If you're less experienced, say you haven't had any significant jobs, but you've done a lot of sort of university service and things like that, then you might actually have a skills-based one. So it really does depend. There's also project ones, and that's quite common in the engineering school, isn't it? Where you talk about the projects and what you've contributed to those projects. I think also in ICT, they like a bit of project-based CV as well.
So with the skills-based one, you've got the separate skills section, but it's not just time management, communication skills, excellent team worker. It's actually providing the evidence. So it's how you've done that. So you talk about, like what we showed before, that you were part of a project team of four people, but then it's also how you contributed to the team. So they can get a really good grasp of what you would be like in working for them, in a team environment working for them. So it's providing that how information, so a bit extra. And then the traditional one is what I was talking about before, where the skills these days are incorporated under the work experience, and it's less task focused. So you'd have a look and think about your role, think about would the reader know what I actually did in this job? And if they do know, you don't have to go into a whole lot of details about the task unless it's really relevant. Instead, what you'll do is talk about the skills that you used. You'd talk about like that 2 degrees ad, you'd talk about the innovation and the team and the leadership experience and how you are a leader, the type of leader you are, whether you sort of operate on consensus, etc.
Just a question about that 10-second average. I'm just trying to understand the CV review process.
Yep.
So are you saying that on average it takes 10 seconds for a recruiter to decide whether to take you on for an interview, Or is it more iterative, as in that's for the first cut, and you might get 2 minutes after that?
Yeah, it's the first cut. So they will form an impression within 10 seconds. And usually what they do is they have a yes, a no, and a maybe pile. Most recruiters we talk to, and I did that myself, is we had those three piles. So then you'd be going through really quickly because you've got, you know, 250 plus all your other jobs as well. The other work doesn't stop, so you're going through quite fast. And so yes, you'll form a very quick impression, and some of them are really easy to put in the no straight away. And then other ones, you're essentially looking at it, trying to come up with a reason not to interview them. And as soon as you find that reason not to interview, you stop. And that's really sad, but that's how you can do it so quickly. And so then you might end up with some in the maybe, and then some in the yes. You'll have a look and see how many you've got in the yes, and then you'll look at the maybe pile, and then you will decide whether to go back through it or not. So you are reading to sort of basically to cut them out as opposed to opt them in. So as soon as you find a reason not to, you stop reading. Also too, recruiters, everyone does it differently. So some think the CV is the most important thing. Others think the cover letter is way more important. So some people will read the cover letter first and then the CV. Others will start with the CV. If they're still interested, then they will go to the cover letter. Which means for you, you need to put equal importance on both because you don't know which they will read first. And you don't actually know if they'll ever read the cover letter at all, for that matter. So I used to work in a not-for-profit, and we hired a lot of people with clinical backgrounds, and I was looking for a certain education. So I would look at the CV, go straight to the education section to see if they had the qualification I wanted. If it wasn't there, they would go in the no. If they put it somewhere else, they were out of luck.
Now, another way to differentiate yourself, you might do an online CV. And we've got an example here of, now this is someone relatively famous, head, I think, honcho at Yahoo, so she should be pretty fluent online. But as you can see, it follows a lot of the same sorts of things that an ordinary CV might have, but it just uses interesting graphics. It has some quite interesting stuff. I thought this A Day in My Life one was a part of it was quite interesting. But yeah, so much of it is like a standard CV, but with some additional bells and whistles.
So you'd think very carefully about the industry that you're applying to, the type of company. So if in New Zealand you were applying to a telecommunication company, you might do something a little bit different for 2 Degrees or Vodafone than you would do for Spark. So you do need to think about the industry, the type of company, so that Day in My Life might be suitable for some, but not for others.
Now, I mentioned action verbs before, and hopefully this is going to come up. Ah, yes. So you'll see here just a variety of different words that you could use. They have a sort of a strength about them. So rather than being sort of quite passive, you can Google action verbs for careers and get a whole lot of variety of different ones to use. One thing is that, as it says on its website, don't use them all at once. I have seen a CV with developed. Managed. So mix and match a bit. Now another thing to be aware of is that we've talked about the sort of the filtering process. Well, sadly, a human being might not do that. It could actually be a robot that does it. Applicant tracking systems, they're not overwhelmingly used in New Zealand apart from larger organisations, are they, Peter? But they are used more and more, and I suspect when people are recruiting large numbers of people, then it's going to become a trend. So in these, do use those keywords. Make sure that you use standard fonts rather than fancy fonts that the computer might not be able to read. Use proper punctuation and capitalisation, really important. Do spell check. because the computer won't like it if there are typos, or it might not understand it. And check the employer's requirements reformatting. It could be that a PDF will muck up their tracking system. And so that's one possibly one of the reasons that they might ask for a Word document. Yeah, and be careful with use of abbreviations, because the computer may not know what that abbreviation means. So just it's something to be aware of. So, what should go into your CV? Well, definitely your personal information, education and qualifications, your achievements, definitely the details of your experience. Don't forget the unpaid work that you might do, the voluntary activities that you might do. Extracurricular activities. Don't think just one of ones that you might have done when you were at university. Think of extracurricular activities that you have done in other parts of your life as well. Professional development, that's a tricky one, because sometimes people will ask, well, should I put all the different courses that I did at such and such an employer? If they're relevant to the new employer, then yes, you might put those professional development courses. But if that employer has required you to have a food safety certificate, then and your new job is as an accountant, then probably you wouldn't put that sort of. So again, it's that relevance test. Referees, you might put your referees in there, but then you might actually you might choose not to, because you might want to actually decide before at the sort of interview who you want to give out as your referees. So that's a you don't have to. Sometimes they might ask for a career goal. They might ask for a personal profile. They might ask for a summary of your skills. So if they do that, then you probably, in fact you wouldn't probably, you'd definitely include those. But if they don't, think about whether those sections actually contribute anything to your story. See if they contribute anything beyond your cover letter. Because if they don't, then they probably are wasted space that you can use on the other areas. And just ensuring that everything is relevant to the role and to the employer. So, I hope that everyone brought along their CVs tonight. What we'd like you to do is just spend a couple of minutes looking at your own CV and thinking about the principles that we've talked about. Have you followed those principles? Are there any improvements that you can that you could make to your CV as a result of what we've discussed? So, a couple of minutes to look at your own CV, and then if you could discuss it as a group, you don't have to show your CV to anyone. Don't worry about that. But anything that you think that you might want to improve in your CV in the future. Okay, if we can come back to the centre now. So, as I've been talking to a few people, I've noticed people are sort of scribbling things on their CVs. So it seems that there are a few people who are going to be making a few amendments to their CVs with regard to applying those principles to your own CV. One key question that we had was around what Peter said about representing your skills. And this gives you a sense of how you could represent those skills. So say for that communications one, where he talks in some detail about what he did in that particular role. So he's got that list of skills at the bottom, but he's also got some detail on the skills that he used and applied during that role. So does that give you a sort of a sense of that how to use the skills in your CV?
Okay, so, strong introduction. The most important part about the cover letter is that first introduction. We are running over time, I'm sorry. I hope that's okay with all of you. We've only got a few more slides. So strong introduction, why they should consider you, why you want the position. So quite commonly someone will say that I'm interested in applying for XYZ position, and then they just leave it at that and they don't say why. So that why and that enthusiasm is really important, and be really genuine. Personalising it to the role and organisation, that goes without saying. Highlights and key achievements. So you would do that exercise where you go through, look at the advertisement, the job description, and then using sort of that repetition, decide what you think the most important skills, personal qualities are for the role, and you'd focus on those. You don't want a shopping list and just basically sort of throw in every single skill that they've asked for. Focus on maybe 4 or 5 of the really most important ones with a bit of evidence. And then the closing paragraph saying thank you. In terms of why you want to work for that company, it's not just repeating what you've seen on the website. It's what I was talking about before, where you show that you've actually, yes, you're passionate about working for 2 degrees, the customer service, and you've demonstrated that through your career. And then doing the research. So researching the organisation, what Tamsin was saying about looking at the website or the company literature as well. And then just that whole enthusiasm thing. So essentially that first paragraph is why you're applying for the job. Second one, the mix of skills, experience and qualifications. There might actually be a couple of paragraphs on that. And then another paragraph about why the organisation. And then that final one, sort of thanking them for considering your application. Some employers want application forms and they can be repetitive. You can sort of think, well, I've got that in my CV, but you shouldn't just put refer to my CV on there. So they've designed the form for a particular purpose. So even though it seems like you're repeating it yet again, still fill out everything on that application form.
And sometimes the question on those application forms can seem a bit odd or a bit quirky, and you might think, oh, this is a joke, they don't really want to know this. Answer that question as well, because it won't be a joke, they will have a reason for asking that question.
So yes, application forms can have a wide range of different questions, including interview questions, which can be off-putting, but you use the STAR formula for most of those as well. So in the future, we've talked about LinkedIn, and some employers are just asking for like a cover letter and your LinkedIn URL rather than an actual CV. And so we've seen that over the last couple of years. It hasn't sort of turned into a big trend yet.
It's not really taken off, but there are a few, aren't there? Yeah.
We think that it might be a growing thing. Another thing you can do if you like sort of the whole online environment is have your own website. So have your own domain name, have your own website, or you can use a site like WordPress, or there's another one called Branded Me. If you like doing that sort of stuff, then by all means do it. And it's quite helpful in terms of your social media, because you can have everything all feeding into the website, and the website is the central hub. If you don't like online stuff, then I wouldn't do it. If you're going to do it, then you'd want to do it well. So this is one example on Branded Me where she's got a lot of different projects. So you click on one of the pictures and it takes the employer through to different details. And then also recommendations as well. LinkedIn, use the recommendations feature on LinkedIn. So get recommendations from managers and also colleagues. The other one was the MJ Ryder one that we showed you, which is slightly more traditional to that Branded Me one. So he has a blog and then he has his CV, but he also has portfolio. He's doing a PhD at the moment and he's got a lot of research on there as well. But in terms of the look of his curriculum vitae, it is more traditional, more what you'd expect. The other trend is blind applications. So that's partly why they might use an application form. or they might use particular software. So by that it means it strips off your name. They have no idea your name. They don't even see what school you went to. Lots of different things. So anything that could identify your nationality or your gender, things like that, are just taken out of the application.
And that's to remove unconscious bias. So it's really, there's the only thing they can assess you on is what is left in the application that they see.
Okay. And that, sorry, we've gone over time, but that's the end of the workshop, unless you've got some more questions. Okay, we'll send you, Courtney will send you a PDF tomorrow.